Learn about 3 new key enhancements to Azure SQL Database Hyperscale in the areas of performance, size, and something called continuous priming. Learn all about it this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Aditya, who is a product manager on the Azure SQL Database team. I'm pretty sure largely focused on Hyperscale. Aditya, welcome back to Data Exposed.
Hey, Anna. How are you?
I'm good. It's great to have you back on the show. I think we had you on to talk about Hyperscale several months ago, but it's great to have you back. And, you know, as we know, Hyperscale has been generally available for several years now. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, some of the investments that Microsoft is making in Azure SQL Hyperscale?
Sure. As you know, like, we are really betting big on Hyperscale as a technology, particularly for relational databases. We are betting big on it. As a company, we are betting big on this technology because we believe this database will fit in all types of workloads, all types of sizes, everything. So that's why we are really betting big on it. And the features that you are going to see, which we kind of announced in past summit, are actually a testimony to say that we are really investing a lot on this technology, specifically Azure SQL Hyperscale Database. Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. That's great to hear. And I know I've been seeing it firsthand, but I just want to make sure everybody else knew too. And yeah, exactly. Today, we're going to talk about some of the latest things that have landed. By the time you're watching this video, maybe a couple weeks ago, maybe a month or two ago, but they're there for you to go check out. I think there are 3 big things we want to touch on, but Aditya, why don't you walk us through what's new?
Sure. So let me share my screen. Yeah, hopefully you can skip my screen. So we in Hyperscale Database, the biggest thing that we are doing is we are kind of listening to the feedback from the customers, and we are saying, what is the right size that we would have? And there are multiple enterprise customers and came to us and said, hey, we are doing good, but we would want to have more size. And to really make sure that we are equivalent to all our competes databases, we made Hyperscale Database right now to 128 terabytes. Previously, we are at 100 terabytes. Now it is going to 128 terabytes. It's right now generally available for all the Hyperscale single databases. So you can essentially grow your database to 128 terabytes.
Amazing.
For Elastic Pool, you are going to get in later, but for all the single databases, it's all generally available. And there is one other feature that which is of a popular demand, that is the increase in log generation rate. To really get this maximum log generation rate, we increased from 100 Mbps to 150 Mbps, which means you can load a lot of data so faster into these databases. 150 Mbps, by the way, is one of the highest ingestion rate that you are seeing in the market compared to other competes also. So this is another thing that we kind of did. Now, this one is in the limited preview as we are speaking, which means any customer who already have the Hyperscale Database, if they want to get enrolled into it, please go into aka.ms/hsenhancements and please submit the form so that we can enable 150 Mbps for you folks.
Cool. I mean, that's a huge one. I mean, that's 50% higher. And like this was already pretty high compared to some of the other database offering. So
yes.
150, that's awesome to see that.
Yeah. And we have worked with a number of enterprise customers with 150 Mbps in the private preview, Anna. And I'm really happy to tell you that it is really satisfying majority of the workloads with 150 Mbps. We were able to ingest a lot of mission critical data into the databases super fast with this 150 Mbps. And we are not stopping here. We are working to dial this more. And I'm sure there are customers who would want more than this. We are not stopping ourselves here. We are
awesome.
Trying to make our technology to get better. But right now we are at 150 Mbps.
Great. Okay. So that's either one update or that's two. It seems like two pretty big updates to me. What else is there?
Yeah, so this one, so let's see how you can monitor this in the database watcher. So if you go into database watcher, you can see right now the maximum data storage is 128 terabytes. And the cool part is you need not provision anything. When you create a hyperscale database, you're getting a 128 terabytes worth of database. All you need to do is go on, add your data, and we will expand your storage automatically. So you need not worry about, hey, do I need to provision anything or such? No, right. It is automatically available and it is growing as your workload grows till 128 terabytes. And the same is with the log generation rate too, which means whenever you have a database which is asking you for a log generation rate, you can essentially go and ingest data with 150 MBPS. Here in Database Watcher, essentially you can see that as a proof where you can essentially ingest 150 MBPS of data.
Nice.
Yeah. And there is one other feature that I'm really, really interested and proud of, which is called continuous priming. This is the general hyperscale architecture, right, Anna? Like, everyone knows about it. You have a read-write copy. You have read-only copies. All of this data is stored in something called page servers, which is the cache layer. And there is a permanent storage called data storage layer. This is what is the general hyperscale architecture is. But there is a one single problem that all our customers used to tell us. That is, you have a primary replica and you have a HA replica, right? Whenever you fail over from primary replica to HA replica, for you to get the same kind of performance as primary replica, you need to wait for some time such that all the data is coming back to HA replica's buffer pool and SSD cache. This is not really a valid way for mission-critical workloads where immediately after failover, nobody wants to go through those performance bottlenecks. And hence, we have introduced this feature called continuous priming. In continuous priming, what we essentially do is we kind of look at all the active pages list, which means, let's say you have a table with 10 records and you are frequently querying it. We nominate that as the hot pages. We push that active pages to page servers. We have a record of what is the hotness levels. And we kind of sort it via hotness, which means how much each page is touched. And we kind of get all that hot pages back onto all the HA replicas, which means when you fail over, your HA replica will be almost ready as the primary replica and will not have any kind of performance bottlenecks.
Got it. Okay. So if I understand this correctly, help me. Like basically what you're doing is you're making it so that when I do a failover, it's not like I'm starting with a cold cache. It's like I have this kind of hot cache based on my actual usage ready to go.
Yep. You got it right. So we kind of did a test for that. So we have pushed 10,000 transactions per second into the database. And we did a failover at this 2:32 p.m. And when we did that failover at 2:32 p.m., for the HA primary to catch that workload, it took almost 4 minutes to catch that workload and start doing again 10,000 transactions per second. All through this while, the amount of weights that you see are page IO latch SH. That is IO in it, which means it's going and fetching the record and putting back onto the buffer pool and trying to do it. So it is that there is a performance bottlenecks for 4 minutes altogether. But after we turned on continuous priming, this became only 1 minute, less than a minute. And page IO latch dropped to 1% of what you were seeing previously, which means your workload immediately after failover, within no time, is ready to serve for the prime time, which means no performance bottlenecks whatsoever. So all this is only possible because of the architecture with which we have. We have all the page servers and the disaggregated compute and storage layer is essentially making this possible to bring such technologies for you folks.
Amazing. And one question I have for you, Probably we could do a whole episode just so we understand what's happening here. But one question I have for you is there any impact on the primary when I have continuous priming turned on?
No impact at all, because we are doing everything on the backend. All the data that is stored is in the backend of the page servers and everything. And the write replica or the primary replica that you have is essentially doing the work that it is always doing. It is writing into buffer pool and writing into RBPEX, which is always doing. We change the algorithms to understand what is the hotness and bringing back to the HA replicas immediately after we understand the hotness.
I see. And is it the log service that's bringing the data back to the...
No. It's in the page servers. The data pages, each page server is 128 GB, right? Let's say page server 1 has data of students. Page server 2 has the data of teachers. And you are touching 10 pages of students and 10 pages of teachers. Those were stored in those respective page servers. So which means log service, it's not touched at all.
Oh, right.
It's in the page servers.
And the page server is sending the data back.
Back to the HA replicas.
Amazing. Cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Awesome. Okay. This is super exciting and huge improvement. And from a customer's perspective, once we light this up for everybody, right now it's an unlimited preview, you'll just run faster, right?
Yep. That's the hope. And because of this, many customers asked for this, and no customer, even when there is a planned maintenance window or fixed maintenance window, whenever their databases goes from one place to another, they will not be seeing any performance impact because of those failovers.
Amazing. Awesome. Well, Aditya, thanks so much for coming on the show. Personally, I learned a lot. So appreciate your patience with my questions. I'm sure our viewers also learned a lot. To our viewers, check out the aka.ms/HS enhancements link. We'll put it in the description for you to learn more. Leave us a comment and let us know which enhancement you're most excited about. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.